So Gideon and his army got up early and went as far as the spring of Herod. Something we need to know about the spring of Herod. Herod means trembling. It means fear. So Gideon and his men are traveling and they stop in a place called fear. I don't know your journey tonight. I don't know where you're coming from or where you are in this moment. But I know with just recent events that have happened in our city, things that are unfolding every single day, we find ourselves by the spring of Herod. We find ourselves in this place called fear. And they actually set up camp in this place of trembling. The Bible goes on to say that the armies of Midian were camped north of them in the valley near the hill of Morah. Now, Morah means teacher. So they're in a place of hiding. They're in a place of fear. They're in a place of trembling. And in the distance, the army that God has called them to fight is in a place called teacher. See, what you need to learn is beyond the sphere of your fear. And it looks like the enemy sometimes. And many of us, we would rather retreat from the enemy and stay in a place called fear rather than advance on the enemy so that we can learn the lesson that God has for us in the middle of the battle. So the Lord says to Gideon, you've got too many warriors. You got too many people. You got too many people just hanging on, hanging out, chilling around you. You need to break some of them off. And so he says, anyone that's afraid, tell them to go home. 22,000 people left because they were afraid. When you make up your mind that you are going to go after what God has for you, when you're going to go after the presence of God, get ready to lose followers. You can't be afraid to lose the 22,000 because God has got something greater up ahead of you. So the 22,000 go home. He's only left with 10,000 willing to fight. Anybody in here willing to fight? Anybody in here willing to fight? Are you willing to fight for your home? Are you willing to fight for your family? Are you willing to fight for your church? Are you willing to fight for your city? Are you willing to fight for your college campus? Are you willing to fight for your workplace? Some of y'all are. Just like some of them were. But you know what God said? You still rolling too deep, dog. I want you to go to a stream. And I'm going to test the men that are with you. And if they kneel down to drink from the stream, I'm sending them home. But if they pull the water in their hands and drink from their hands, I'm letting them stay with you. Only 300 stayed. This army of over 35,000 has now been pruned down to 300. But how many of y'all know that little is much when God is in it? When you have God on your side, you have the majority. So the Midianite camp was in the valley below Gideon, and the Lord said, get up and go down to the Midianite camp, for I have given you the victory over them. But if you are afraid to attack, so this is a funny statement, because the Lord says, I've given you the victory over them. Gideon is not convinced, because the Lord goes on to say, but if you are afraid to attack, go down to the camp with your servant. Listen to what the Midianites are saying, because the enemy has been talking about you. We over here worried about them. They over there worried about us. And so Gideon goes down and he sneaks up on the enemy camp, and he hears two of them talking, and one of them is sharing a dream that he had. And he says, I saw this Now, this is kind of a funny word picture. Forgive me, but it's what the Bible says. A loaf of barley. I don't know what that is. Just a giant piece of bread is what I see. And it rolls down into the camp and it crushes the enemy campsite. See, God's got enough bread for you. Hey, you like what I did there? Yo, how that you, boy? And crushes. See, and Gideon hears this, and he falls down, the Bible says, and worships God. Because he hears that the enemy is more afraid of him than he was of them. See, what we gather here is that sometimes God will send us into a valley so that he can teach us about his victory. Sometimes God will send you into a low place so that he can show you his strength. And when faced with difficulty, we really only have two responses. We can either worry or we can worship. And whether we worry or whether we worship is dependent upon who we feel has the most power. Whether you worry or your worship is determined by your perspective. How do you see the enemy? How do you see the difficulty? How do you see the struggle? How do you see the days ahead? How do you see the empty blanks where you don't quite have all of the answers? You can worry about what's ahead, or you can worship, because God has already given you the victory necessary for where he is taking you. In fact, where you are going, you already have a reputation because of whose side you are on. And if the Lord is on your side, if God be for me, who can be against me? And so Gideon goes back. He's hyped up at this point. He goes back to his 300 men and he's like, yo, here's what we're gonna do. I want you to get the clay pots with the torches in them. And I want you to get the trumpets. And I want you to follow me to the edge of the camp. But watch what he says. He says, keep your eyes on me. When I come to the edge of the camp, do just as I do. If you're a leader in the house tonight, I want to let you know that everyone else is keeping their eyes on you. That's why worship leading and being in a band and serving in the shadows, it's so important that we have a posture of worship regardless of where we're standing or what spotlight hits us or doesn't hit us, because as we do, they do. Leaders go first. So, translation, that means I don't wait on someone else to clap, I clap. I don't wait on someone else to lift my hands, I lift my hands. I don't wait for someone to come to the front and kneel, I kneel. I don't wait to see how much money they're getting out of their wallet or sending through with Apple Pay before I give my offering. I go first. Leaders go first. And there are people in the room that are watching you, and they're going to make a decision based on what you do. Gideon says, keep your eyes on me. Watch what I do. And at the perfect moment, he splits them up into different groups, sends them out, and surrounds the enemy camp. Only 300 of them. And the Bible says that there were so many of the enemy that you could not even count the camels. The camels were like sand on a seashore. And at the perfect moment, the Bible says, they blew the ram's horns. They broke their clay jars. Then all three groups blew their horns and broke their jars. They held the blazing torches in their left hand and the horns in their right hands. And they all shouted, "A sword for the Lord and for Gideon." Each man stood at his position around the camp. Some of y'all need to take position in this room right now, because we are about to blow the roof off of this place and worship to a holy God. The Bible says when the 300 Israelites blew their ram's horns, the Lord caused the warriors in the camp to fight against each other. You've heard the saying in church, praise confuses the enemy. This is why. Because as they began to blow those horns and as they broke those jars and lifted those torches, the enemy started attacking each other and they wiped themselves out. I love this picture because it starts with an act of brokenness. It's a picture of worship. The first thing that they had to do was take that clay jar and break it. See, God uses broken things. God uses broken hearts. God uses broken dreams. And God bless the broken road. Dang. Rascal Flatts. Spirit of God. Lord, come. Save to a country song. But a lot of times we think that worship is an expression of our strength, but really it's an admission of our weakness. It's us saying, God, I don't have the weapons. I don't have the tools. I am outnumbered. I am not enough. But if I allow myself to be broken in your presence, to be contrite, to humble myself, to relieve myself of ego, to set all of my accolades down, to not care so much about what people think of me, if I could allow myself to be broken in his hands, then he could release the fire of his spirit. Because within these clay jars were torches, but it wasn't until the jar was broken that the flame was revealed. See, so many of us want the spirit and the glory of God, but we don't want to be broken in the presence of God. Oh, it's my heart to be broken. I don't want to have it all together. I don't want to have all the ducks in a row. God, I want to be broken in your presence. I want to think less of myself. Because we can just believe our own gas so much. Want to be broken. And then they took the torches. They raised it up in their left hand. That torch represents the power of God. Fire in the Bible always represents God's presence. Also in the Bible, side note, the left hand is always the weak hand. God has got enough presence for your weakness. As a matter of fact, his strength is made perfect in your weakness. So we raise in our weakness the presence of God. While we raise in the other hand, they raised trumpets. Trumpets were the instrument of declaration in the Bible. When the Lord returns for his church, there is going to be the sound of a trumpet. There is a message that always accompanies a trumpet. So on one hand, you have the sound of declaration. And in the other hand, you have the fire of the presence of God. And then he told him to do this one last thing, to shout. To shout the name of the Lord, the sword of the Lord. Isn't it interesting that the posture of worship is this? Lord, I give you my heart.
give you my soul. I live for you alone. Every breath I take, every moment I'm awake. Lord, have your way in me.
The presence of God, the declaration of God, needs your voice to overcome the enemy. When these things worked together in unison, God gave Gideon a complete victory. And in the end of that complete victory, the warriors chased them down to a place called Beth Bera, which is called a place of safety. Look at the progression. Took them from a place of fear to a place of teaching to a place of safety. And the only thing between the place of teaching and the place of safety was worship. I don't know if you're looking for a safe place tonight, but I can show you the path. I can show you the path to a place of refuge. I can show you a path to a place of acceptance and affirmation. I can show you a path to a place of healing, to a place of peace and comfort. It's this narrow road called worship. And when you begin to worship, victory begins to happen. Would you stand all over this room? You feel like you've been surrounded, but God has actually positioned you to surround the thing you think you've been surrounded by. And so what I'm going to do right now is I'm going to ask you to get in the posture of war. This is how we fight our battles. This is how we fight our battles. Left hand up, right hand up. Voice activated. Left hand up, right hand up, voice activated. Left hand up, right hand up, voice activated. We call on the name of the Lord. We declare the glory of God. He is good and his mercy endures forever. He is good and his mercy endures to every generation. Come on, Lakewood Young Adults. We don't need a song. We don't need a lyric. We don't need a guitar lick. All you need is your voice and your hands. You are the instrument of deliverance. You are the instrument of power. You are the instrument of worship. Come on and lift your voice. Give God your highest hallelujah. We give you praise. We give you honor. We give you glory. Come on, more than a shout. He wants worship. He wants the cry of your heart. He wants the affirmation of your soul. We give you glory, Lord. Come on and lift your voice. Come on, we in the posture of war.
This is how I fight my battle.
Think about the thing that's been coming against you. Think about the thing that's been plaguing you. Think about the addiction. Think about the brokenness. Come on, it's about to happen in this place. Say!
This is how I fight my battle.